الله والصلاه على رسوله الكريم اما بعد اعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم من كان يرجو لقاء الله فان اجل الله لآت صدق الله العظيم. Today we are going to discuss the opposite of khawf. Just as a recapitulation, I just want to re-emphasize for a person who wants to tread the path of the tasawwuf, who wants to purify his heart, there are two types of struggle he has to make. One is the physical mujahada, the physical striving he has to do, whereby he has to sleep less, eat less, talk less, and associate less with people, and we have dealt with those four aspects. Once a person starts doing that, he starts monitoring his body, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts opening his heart, and the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the effulgence of the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests in his heart, and then the desire to do amal. There are two types of amal. One is amal zahir and one is amal batin. Amal zahir are the what you call fiqh, that is a jurisprudence that we know, namaz, roza, zakat, hajj, doing business, etc. And amal batin, the hidden, the internal actions got to do with the heart. This is what the very first lecture we did was, what was the status of the heart in Sharia. So these are actions that we do in our heart, shukr, sabr, etc. And from there on, we have to, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created all those actions into two, the opposites. Without opposites, we cannot appreciate the good ones. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created the angels, and He has created Iblis and the shayateen as well. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created anger, He has created tolerance as well. Without the opposite, it's difficult to appreciate what is our spiritual evolution. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at times makes our heart feel the opposite as well, so that we can understand the need to evolve spiritually. So we did discuss last time that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one thing He wants with us, which is very important, is taqwa. Taqwa means to abstain from the hurmat, and the fear of Allah comes in our heart, which is khawf. And we did discuss about khawf last week, the fear that we are to have in our heart, what extent Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects us to have fear. And we did discuss the attributes, the actions of some people who have fear in them, how they were behaving. Today, we're going to discuss the opposite of fear, which is hope. This is very, very important. In Arabic, we call it raja. Khawf and raja, these are the two qualities that a Muslim must be able to develop in him. It's just like a bird. A bird that has two wings, it will fly very, very nicely. But if one of the wings is not well, is not in a good condition, there will be an imbalance in this bird. For this reason, it must have both wings. But what can happen is, if none of that exists, it doesn't have a single wing, what will happen? It will die. In the same way, a mu'min who doesn't have this feeling in his heart, the fear of Allah, then definitely he will not be able to do good action and to abstain from bad action. On the other hand, if a person hasn't have hope at all in Allah, then this will destroy his iman as well, because you are challenging the quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khawf and raja, that is the quality of fear and the quality of hope, this is what's called iman. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith to this effect, that iman is found between hope and fear, between fear and hope. This is why the ulama explained, if a person has only hope in him, Allah is Ghafoor Rahim, then he does all bad things, this will develop into idleness. He will have no desire to reform himself. And if a person has only fear in him, this will develop into despondency. That also is not a good thing. For this reason, a mu'min must have both in him. We're going to discuss a few examples of the great wali of Allah, how the hope in them changed their own life, how they were looking at the concept of raja, which is a very, very, very important concept a Muslim must develop in him. Because the ultimate thing that a Muslim wants, the ultimate aim of a Muslim, even in Jannah, there will be something more better than Jannah, is to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Didare ilahi. This is the greatest gift that a Muslim will want to have. There is no greater gift than this, because Allah is the creator of Jannah. If you can see Allah Himself, what is a Jannah? Jannah is nothing. Jannah has been created for us. Allah created Jannah for insan. So what's the great deal about Jannah? Like once it was asked about to a person, what do you prefer, to read 2 rakat nafil or to go in Jannah? He said, I prefer 2 rakat nafil because Jannah is for my pleasure, but the 2 rakat nafil is for the pleasure of Allah. This is how the Wali of Allah thinks. We would like to go in Jannah, but the Wali of Allah don't think like this. They have reached a level of anahiyat. They have destroyed their own ego and they have left everything for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is where a Muslim, when he goes in the Jannah, even the Jannah won't be of interest to him when he knows what is dirar ilahi. It comes in hadith where a mu'min will be among his hur in Jannah. Each time he will see Allah, and when he come back to his hur, to his damsels of Jannah, they will tell him that today you are more beautiful. Just your sight following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your beauty will increase in Jannah. So what is Jannah compared to just seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It comes in hadith, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will read Surah Rahman, because he said that first Dawud alayhi salatu wasalam, Dawud alayhi salam will be asked to read, he had a beautiful voice. When he used to read Zabur, it is said that the bird was singing with him. The mountains were singing with him, was reciting Zabur. This is how his voice was melodious. Then Rasulullah salam will read Quran. Then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will read Ar-Rahman, it is reported that the all 7 heavens will start swinging. Who is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? This didar ilahi is even above the Jannah. So this hope, this yearning of meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the ultimate aim of tasawwuf. To purify yourself, to purify ourselves to such an extent that we feel, oh Allah, we don't deserve seeing you, but the love for you is forcing us to meet you. This is what it is all about. Clean this heart to such an extent that we are finished with fear, the level of fanahiyat, that Allah comes above our desires. This is why the quality of hope is the quality that will sustain a Muslim. This is a quality that will sustain a Muslim in the akhirat. What is the meaning of hope? Hope, to have raja, is a quality that a mu'min must develop in him. A Muslim must develop this quality in his heart. Hope is a quality that for something which you love, something that you love, will happen in the future. It is the opposite of fear. Fear was something that you are afraid you will lose in the future. Hope is something that you can get in the future. This is the meaning of hope. And what is the thing? Maghfirat of Allah. The bounty of Allah. The divine grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Or maybe Jannah also. These are the hope that we can have. And yearning, developing that in a Muslim, it really creates the desire to do amal-e-salih. You got to differentiate between hope and wishing for something. Hope is a special quality in the heart of a mu'min. He will yearn to do good action, good amal, so that he can get the maghfirat of Allah on the day of Qiyamah. So that he is showered by the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that he gets the fazl of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests himself in his heart. This tranquility, peace that he will get out of those actions, this will create the hope in him that no, I've got a hope that Allah is hearing my dua. I've got a hope Allah will forgive me. I've got a hope Allah will make me pass my exam. I've got a hope Allah will take me out of my musibat. But wishing, just to wish for something, that leads to laziness. Oh, I want to wish to, I wish to marry this woman. So what? You want to wish to marry a woman, that's a wish. But you hope to marry her, you make the effort to marry her. That's the difference. Not to wish for Jannah, we have to make effort. I always tell the parents who want to their children to have to become Hafiz al-Quran. It's not easy to produce a Hafiz al-Quran. I did mention it before as well. They say, no, I wish my child to become a Hafiz al-Quran. The child will not become Hafiz al-Quran like this. The greatest sacrifice comes from the parents. You got to make sure you will wake up before the child. Maybe read 2 rakat tahajjud for this child to become a hafiz. Then you're going to wake up this child to do his door or maybe to take him to his maulvi sahab. Then go and fetch him, take him back to school. Then maybe take him to madrasa. After madrasa hours, go and take him back to the maulvi sahab. Then after maghrib isha, go and fetch him again. The parents will have to make more effort. Then you produce a hafiz al-Quran. So those parents who just wish, is very difficult. It's not impossible, but very difficult to produce a son who is hafiz al-Quran. But a father who got hope, keeping all the ahadith of Rasulullah that his child will become a hafiz, he will put effort. So this is the difference between hope and wishing. We can wish for something, but that leads to laziness. But hope is a quality that need to be nurtured. There are three types of people who has hope. Three types. One are those type of people, they do good actions and they have hope that their action will be accepted by Allah. They have hope Allah will accept the action. Mawlana Mashullah Khan Sahib rahmatullah alayh gave a ajeeb waqiyah that on the day of Qiyamah, one person will go to in the darbar of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Addressing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is confident he has done good actions. And he worships nobody but Allah. So, Ya Allah, so what you brought today? So, Ya Allah, I brought Tawheed for you today. I bow my head in front of nobody but you. Allah says, you brought Tawheed. You remember such day, you had a pain in your tummy, and you said, I drank milk the day before. The milk caused a pain. Since when milk caused pain? I am the one who gives disease, not the milk. Where is your Tawheed? One action he did, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disapproved of him. Finished completely, he didn't know what to do anymore. Then Allah told him, you know, on such night, there was a kitten. It was raining. The kitten was in a drainage, and it was like dying. That night, it was a pitch dark night. That night, nobody could see you. You took that my creation out of Raham for my creation. You took it out of this train, of this position. You look after it. You dried it, and the kitten was okay. That you did for me. On that, I'm going to give you Jannah. At times, we don't know what action is going to give us Jannah. We think our actions are good. I told you last week that Sufyan Thawri rahmatullah alayh, when he passed away, Raliban was Sufyan Thawri rahmatullah alayh or Junaid Baghdadi. No, Junaid Baghdadi rahmatullah alayh, where when he passed away, one of his friends dreamt of him and told him, what you did? Say, I went to Allah. All my actions were thrown away, like wind blowing away the dried leaves. It was two rakat, tahajjud once I read, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted that for me. So this is hope. We don't know. We don't know what is death. It is reported of great ulama, like Imam Razi, Fakhruddin Razi rahmatullah alayh, who wrote Tafsir-e-Kabir. Tafsir-e-Kabir is one of the most difficult tafsir ever written in the world. Imam Razi rahmatullah alayh. He is a tafsir based on logic. Every ayat of Quran, he gives you the logic of this ayat. Everything is based on logic. Very, very difficult. They say that in Tafsir-e-Kabir, there is everything but nothing. There is everything but nothing. You don't understand. And you must be great ulama who go and read this. A person like me can't even open Tafsir-e-Kabir. So difficult. It's based on mantiq, logic. So on the time of death, it is reported that Iblis came to him. Iblis asked him, prove me Allah exists. He gave one answer. Iblis broke it. Second answer, Iblis broke it. He gave 99 proof of the existence of Allah. Iblis broke all the argument of Imam Razi because he was giving from mantiq, logic. But Iblis had more experience than him in this world. Then, when he was Halat al-Sakrat, it is reported that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unveiled it to his sheikh, his spiritual guide. His spiritual guide, seeing Imam Fakhruddin Razi in a big difficulty, he said, just tell Iblis that I believe in Allah, I don't have to give you any proof for that. He said that and his ruh went in his kalima. That is Imam Razi, Fakhruddin Razi, rahmatullah alayh. The hope of Allah, even at the time of death, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, rahmatullah alayh, at the time of death, Imam Ahmad bin Hanbal, rahmatullah alayh, at the time of death, he said, not yet. People say, what? To who is talking? He said, not yet. People ask him, Imam Sahib, what are you saying? He says, Shaitan is coming by me. Shaitan is by me. He says, hey, Imam Ahmad, you managed to run away from me, na? He says, no, my ruh is still in my body. I can't say that I'm dying a Muslim. I'm telling you great personalities, brothers, who are we? These are people who have marked the history of Islam. These are people who have turned the path of history. These are the people who are having this type of death. What is their hope on Allah on that time of death when ruh is coming out? So the Muslim must nurture this quality of hope. Oh Allah, give us the life to die with iman. This must be the quality of a mu'min, this hope to die with iman, to have maghfirat of Allah at the time of death. It's not easy to die as a mu'min. It's not easy at the time of death. One day, inshallah, we're going to talk on death. What is death? What is death? When the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I'm going, inshallah, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give tawfiq, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in Surah Amma, the last ayat, where Allah SWT says, on that day, everybody will be panic-stricken, and where the kafir will say, kash, I was, alas, I wish I was dust on that day. Why this ayat was revealed? What will happen on the day of Qiyamah? What will happen to death? What will happen to Malik al-Maut on Maidani Hashar? That's also the bahas on that. What is death? So, a Muslim, he must try to nurture his heart to get this. So, first thing is, will Allah accept our actions on the day of Qiyamah? We must have hope. The second category of hope that we can have is a person does evil actions, bad actions, but he has hope for forgiveness. The third one is, he does bad actions and he has hope Allah will heal you. Allah is Ghafoorul Rahim. Allah is Ghafoorul Rahim. That one doesn't work. Then what? Doesn't work. Huh? That's the stupid who will think this way. We got to make the effort to get the closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this quality of Raja is the quality of tranquility that a Muslim will experience when he aims at attaining those favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has hope on the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has hope on the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make hisab kitab easy for him. These are the guiding stars to make this person do good actions. On the other hand, he must not forget about fear. It is said by ulama, if a person, the quality of evil is dominating in him, he's doing more bad action, then the quality of khawf, the quality of fear, must dominate over the quality of hope on Allah. So we must value what is the halat of our heart, where are we going in our heart. So this quality of hope is very, very important that we develop it in us. What are the signs that we have quality of hope in us? The few Sufyan al-Kiram have said there are two signs, two main signs. One is a person who has hope in Allah, he will show the quality of gratefulness, gratitude. In his heart, he has gratitude. The second one is he has full conviction in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh Allah, I'm coming in your darbar with full of sin, but oh Allah, you're Ghafoor Rahim. Oh Allah, you're Rahman. Your quality of mercy overpowers your quality of anger. Based on this, he has hope that Allah will forgive him. He knows he's doing bad action, but he has this hope that Allah will forgive him. Persistently, he knows, this pain is his mind, but he knows that Allah will forgive him. He's making istighfar. Coming on that, it is reported that Ibrahim bin Adam, great wali of Allah, great wali of Allah. He was the king of Balkh. He left. I told you the story of Ibrahim bin Adam. Once he was a king of Balkh, where Afghanistan, this area is. And he heard a noise on his castle. He wanted to say, who is on my castle? See somebody, say, I'm looking for my camel on your castle. Say, on top, on the roof, you're looking for your camel. Where? Then the person told him, do you think you're going to sit in your castle with all those luxuries, you're going to find Allah? He left everything, he went. Then he became a great wali of Allah, very, very beautiful. His life history, his biography is beautiful. So one day, Ibrahim bin Adam rahmatullah alayh was doing Kaaba. He wanted to do tawaf. Allahu Akbar. Sahid, listen to this. He was wanted to do tawaf alone. It was dark, it was raining, and people were doing tawaf. So it so happened that all everybody went, he was alone. Those days we didn't have big crowd like now. Big crowd started in the 80s. Now only there was big crowd in the haram. In those days there were 30-40 people. Those who went in the 1960s will know, 1950s will know. Now only you got a big crowd at the haram. So when everybody went, he addressed Allah. He found the Kaaba to Allah. Say, Ya Allah, I'm full of sin. I'm asking you protection against sin. Oh Allah, I'm asking you protection against sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent a voice to him. Hey Ibrahim, if I'm going to make all of you sinless, towards who am I going to show my quality of mercy? See the ta'alluq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his banda. Look at this answer that he received. This is what hope is, and how Allah react to hope. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala react to hope. There was a great wali of Allah. He says that the greatest feeling in my heart is hope for Allah. The greatest thing my tongue can produce is zikrullah. The greatest thing. This is a quality that only the heart can understand. the heart that have been purified, all the dirt from is removed from the heart. These are the people who will understand what hope is about. This is a great quality, the quality of hope. Hazrat Umar al-Faruq radiallahu ta'ala says, if it is announced on the day of Qiyamah in Maidan al-Hashr that everybody will go in Jannah, only one person will go in Jahannam, I'm afraid it's going to be me. On the contrary, if it is announced on the day of Maidan al-Hashr that everybody will go in Jahannam, but one person only Allah will set in Jannah, I got hope it is me. This is the ta'alluq that a person who has cleaned his heart got with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's balance. No tafreet, no exaggeration. There's so much logic in what Hazrat Umar al-Faruq radiallahu ta'ala is saying here. So much logic. It is reported, I'll give you one few examples of great personality, how the quality of hope manifests in their life, so that we can take lesson on that. The greatest hope is the ayahs I've quoted to you, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling in the Quran, مَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَى اللَّهِ, whoever has a hope of meeting Allah. Look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put the word hope in the Quran. مَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَى اللَّهِ, that is meeting Allah. Whoever has hope to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَإِنَّا أَجَلَ اللَّهِ لَآتِينَ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is consoling the heart of the walis. Oh my banda, this time is close, it's coming. This time is close. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, we must ponder upon those signs of Qiyamah, that me and Qiyamah, we are like this, two fingers. And the very first sign of Qiyamah already appeared, the advent of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because there won't be another prophet after him. So this is the very first sign of Qiyamah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has come. And he says, me and Qiyamah, we are like this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in the Quran, because you know, we live in this world, we are influenced by this world. Ayat Quran mentions, and those who were in the Qabr, when they will waken up on the Maidan al-Hashr, after how many millennium, they will be asked, how long you stay in the Qabr? He said, a day or part of a day. Just like a person who went for an opt, you are knocked down, anesthetic. Then when you are waking up, you don't know, you lose control, you are disoriented with time. So the same thing happened in the Qabr. When a person sleeps so long in the Qabr, for millennium, he will sleep in millennium. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect him, the effect of time, he will look very, very small. Same thing, what is Qiyamah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling this banda in the Quran, this hope that you have to meet me is very near. For Allah is very, very near. It is reported that one day, a person asked, you see, Allah, a millennium is how long for you? Allah told him, that's 1 second. See, Allah, 1 million pound, 1 billion pound, how much for you? He said, 1 penny. See, Allah, give me 1 penny. Allah told him, wait 1 second. So he had to wait for 1 second. Anyway, astaghfirullah. This is what the people say. Okay. That was about Imam Malik rahmatullah alayh. It is reported that Malik bin Anas radiallahu anhu, when he was on his death, one night before he passed away, one person went to see him. And addressing the great Imam, he said, how do you feel about yourself? Son of Socrates manifesting. He told him, what can I tell you? The forgiveness that is waiting, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give, your eyes, when you will see it with your own eyes, you will not comprehend, you will not imagine the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most merciful. It is beyond our imagination, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is of forgiving. How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look for flimsy reason to make open the door of Jannah for us. Petty things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look. On one night, maybe you don't know, one in the blue night, you woke up and you were 2 rakat tahajjud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take this out to put it on the scale to make face of Jannah. But this should not be the only thing. We must have fear of Allah. We must have this balance. But this is how great Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. When in person of caliber of Imam Malik rahmatullah alayhi is saying something like this, we got to know what he means. It is reported that once Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was addressing a majmu'ah of Sahaba and they were laughing. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came and told them to this effect, you laughing? If you knew what I know, you would have laughed very little and cried a lot. And Rasulullah went, just imagine a person of the caliber of Rasulullah with his awe, with the seal of Nabuwat on his shoulders, he making a statement like this, The whole atmosphere changed. They were panic-stricken. What Rasulullah could have said? What this mean? What kabira guna they have made to laugh? And all type of thought coming in their mind. Then Rasulullah come later on. He said, when I left you, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam brought an ayat. Look at the taluk of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the sahaba ikram. He knew how their heart melted out of fear with the statement of Rasulullah sallam. Immediately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the ayat of the Quran, telling Rasulullah sallam in the Quran, Na'bi ibadi anni anna al-ghafur rahim. Oh Nabi, tell my banda, declare to my banda that me verily, your Allah, I am ghafur rahim. Just how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created that hope. Because they were panic stricken with the statement of Rasulullah. Immediately Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew what was going in the heart of his wali. He came and consoled his heart. There was another sahabi also. Some sahabi went in jihad. Others stayed at the back. So one of his friends told him, you look after my family. So it so happened that when his wife came, he touched his wife by mistake. So this was playing in his mind. What have I done? What have I done? He could not sleep at night. This was tormenting him at night. What have I done? What khayanat have I done? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh my banda, don't lose hope on the rahmat. Because your sincerity in your apologies, in your seeking your forgiveness of your wrong is so great. Don't lose hope on that. You can't torment yourself of a sin. Then why am I ghafurur rahim? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking in the Quran. Why am I ghafurur rahim? If you're going to develop torment yourself for the one sin that you made. So this is a hope that Allah himself, when the Sahaba were going out of control, losing this hope of Allah, Allah himself was revealing. Allah himself was intervening on the heart of the Sahaba to give them this tranquility. That no, the quality of hope is the perfect quality of a mu'min. You cannot be a mu'min if you haven't got hope on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a defect in the iman of a mu'min if you haven't got hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Like a bird, you must have those two in us. It is reported that once Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, another example, as Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, a magian, those who are worshipping fires, etc., asked hospitality to Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. So Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam told him, okay, I'll give you food, but Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam was known for that. He had a very, very big heart in offering food to people. He said, I'm going to give you hospitality, but became a Muslim. The man refused. Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, Khalilullah, he could not take it. How can a worshipper is doing like this? So he's doing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rebuke him. Say, hey Ibrahim, for one day you could not host him. I've been hosting him for 70 years. He has been making kufr. What would have happened if you gave him food for one day? Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam rushed towards him, found him, explained to him. And the person says, this is the reality of your Lord. This is how he treated me, and he became Muslim. It is reported of Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahmatullahi alayhi. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahmatullahi alayhi, was a tabi, very jadilul qadr muhaddith, great warrior. It is said that for 6 months he was in jihad, and 6 months he was in roza and tasnifat and acquiring ilm. This was Abdullah ibn Mubarak, great, great muhaddith, very great alim, was a contemporary of Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmatullahi alayhi, as well. Abdullah ibn Mubarak, rahmatullah alayh, he was going in jihad. Allahu Akbar. While doing jihad, one of the idolaters who was sun worshippers said, can you give me a respite? Because those days they were not fighting with sword, so they could take off while fighting. Can I pray? He said, okay, you go and pray. When you finish pray, then I'll. And he started bowing in front of the sun. Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mubarak could not tolerate the shirk. He lifted his sword to cut off his neck. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blew the wind, and the noise came in the wind. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَأَوْفُوا بِالْأَهْدِ فَإِنَّ الْأَهْدَ مَسْؤُولَ كَانَ مَسْؤُولَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded Hazrat Abdullah ibn Mubarak, fulfill your covenant, fulfill your vow, because you're going to be questioned on the day of Qiyamah for what vow you have taken. So when this man finished, he said, why didn't it do what you were supposed to intended to do? He said, it's only what happened, what he heard in the wind. Then he said, this is the quality of the perfect Lord who is called his friend. Look at this word, beautiful word. This is the quality of a perfect Lord who scolds his friend, Abdullah Mubarak was a Ghatwali of Allah, who scolds his friend to protect his enemy, Allahu Akbar, because he was worshipping a son. He says, this is the quality of the Lord, he became Muslim on the battlefield. This is the type of hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to a mu'min. Like these are so many waqiyat. Time also is over. There is a waqiyah of Rabah al-Qaisi, rahmatullah alayhi. He went for Hajj. Rabah al-Qaisi was a great wali of Allah. And he did many Hajj. So one day he went in front of the Kaaba, addressing Allah. So, Ya Allah, such amount of Hajj is for Rasulullah. 10 for the Sahaba. 2 for my parents. The remaining give it to all the Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the message to him. Hey, Rabah, you have come to my house. You're addressing the Kaaba. In front of the Kaaba, you're showing me your generosity. What about me? What am I supposed to do? Say, go, I've forgiven you, your parents, and all the people. The hope, which is nurtured in the heart of a mu'min, this is a type that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then a little that I'm giving in front of you, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala manifests to the quality of hope in this world itself. We can see many things. Hazrat Dawood alayhi salatu wa salam, it was revealed to Hazrat Dawood alayhi salatu wa salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told Dawood alayhi salatu wa salam, tell the people that I haven't created you for me to benefit from you. I have created you for you to benefit from me. Allahu Akbar. What a message Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is sending through the Mubarak mouth of Dawood alayhi salatu wa salam, that we have to benefit from Allah. Allah hasn't created us to, that He was going to benefit from us. Then, there was another person. This is a beautiful waqia. His name was Yahya bin Aktam. He was very fond of one of his friends and he passed away. And he wanted really to see him. The friend wanted to see him in the dream. So one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him come in the dream. And he asked him, how Allah did with you? You see, Allah told me that I was very unjust towards him. What I have to say? You say, Ya Allah, I have come to you with one hadith of Rasulullah. I'm relying on this hadith that you are not going to put, you are ashamed. You say that you are ashamed to put a person who has white beard, white hair in fire of Jahannam. I'm coming to you based on this hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, oh yeah, my prophet speaks the truth. I'm going to give you Jannah, but you did not do well on earth. Because on hope on one hadith of Rasulullah SAW, he had grey beard. Today we are painting our beard. We want to impress the people. We don't know what is the fazilat of having grey beard. There are many ahadith on that. There are many masla on that, on the beard. We are not allowed to put dye to look young, except on jihad. There is an ikhtilaf. Imam Abu Yusuf rahmatullah alayhi say, if your wife asks you, you can. That's another masla between husband and wife. Like for example, the sunnat way of keeping your beard is, the sunnat is all the things you keep it in. But you can correct it. But you will find that some people, to make haq ada of their wife, they could take it out completely. Completely they take it out. Because if their wives want to kiss them, to fulfill the right of the wife, then you take it. Then this part is wajib. On this bone here, this is wajib. But this, that also, Sharia allows it to fulfill the right of your wife. I've seen people after their wife died, they grow this part as well. But as long as the wife was alive, they shave it completely to make haqqada of their wives. That also is a masla. So grey beard is a great ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Great ni'mat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, once he saw himself in the mirror, he saw grey beard. He said, Ya Allah, what is this? Allah says, wisdom. It's a great sign. Sign of maturity. Today we want to put all type of dye stuff on the market. Huh? We must be very careful on that. There's masla masail on that. But anyway, this was a quality of hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created for us, so that the quality of fear don't overpower us and we become despondent. We lose hope completely. If the quality of fear, if you remember last week we talked about it, how certain wali of Allah were overtaken, like Sufyan Thawri, the fear was so much in him that his liver was eaten up. We gave this example also. So we must be very, very careful. Have this balance in us. Wallah, you Ghafur Rahim. We are your banda. We make sin, but you forgive us. As long as there is sincerity in our heart that we are not going to commit the sin, Allah will forgive us. But there is this doubt in our, because there are four conditions to ask for maghfirat. That inshallah, if we get time, one day we're going to explain. One of it is a sincere intention, we are not going to commit it. But if you commit it again, you repeat the same intention again. Even if it is 1 million times, you do it, no problem. Because by we applying our logic on the sifat of Allah in itself is wrong. Because we can't comprehend Allah with our mentality, with our short mind. How can we understand Allah? How can we apply logic? If Allah is Ghafurur Rahim, Ghafur is also Ghaffar, superlative form, the highest form of forgiving. How can we try to comprehend Allah? We must not apply our mind on this sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah says He's going to forgive, we have hope He will forgive. If Allah asks us to be afraid of Him, we're going to be afraid of Him. For this reason, every day we come to namaz, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has, like, comes the hadith, La salata illa bi fatiha. There is no salah without surah fatiha. It is compulsory to read surah fatiha in the salah. As you know, in the lahnaf it is wajib. But as the imam says, it's compulsory. You got to read surah fatiha. And in surah fatiha, we are revising a very fundamental concept of khawf and raja, fear and hope. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, all praise is for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the Lord of all the universe. Alameen, the plural of alam. This is the grandeur, the capacity, the qudrat of Allah. He created all. Then Allah said, oh banda, don't get afraid when you look at Jupiter, Mars, Neptune, the moon, the space. The vastness of this space I've created, don't get panic. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. I have Raham also. I have Rahim, I'm Rahim also. I will provide you in this world. In the hereafter also I will provide you. But then, don't abuse on my quality of Rahmaniyat. Malik Yawmiddin. I am your Lord on the day of Qiyamah. You got to come to me as well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to understand those two qualities in our salah. That your iman is based on those two qualities in light of hadith of Rasulullah. Iman is between fear and hope. So every day we come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how many times, 40 times, more than 40 times every day, we repeat this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we can concentrate on those things, then we'll see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enlighten our heart, and the quality of hope is that quality that will nurture us to do good actions. This is a quality. Because the highest thing we want to obtain is to see Allah, to meet Allah. And to meet Allah, we must go with a clean heart. To go with a clean heart, we must make effort. I'm going to stop here today. Subhanallah.